Live from Iroquois Park, it's game two of the first round as the series moves to the home of the 2022 Minto Cup champion, Whitby Warriors. They trail the best of five after last night's 11-6 loss to the Mountaineers, led by Finn Thompson's 4 goals and 6 points. Of course, most fit for a finalist of the Green Gales Trophy for OJLL's most valuable player. Meanwhile, multi-goal effort from Lucas Littlejohn in the third period, natural hat trick that brought the Warriors close as they showed plenty of momentum, hopeful to continue that here for a full 60 minutes to even the series tonight. Angs Kumar alongside Pat Gregoire for this exciting matchup almost 24 hours after the first round officially started.
Great news for both sides, with it being the quick turnaround. One, on the side of Mimico, the visitors, they can feed off that momentum. They come off with a great offensive performance. The defense is stout, and they want to get back on the horse. On the flip side, though, for Whitby, short memory, new game, and it all starts right now.
First 30 seconds on the shot clock belong to Mimico. Kirst has it. CJ Kirst coming off a big performance himself. And a whistle already 6 seconds into the contest.
Crew chief Andrew Ecclestone handing off a couple of roughings just 6 seconds into the game, and it's Littlejohn and Taguri, who Taguri has done a great job covering Littlejohn. He's been all over him early on in this series, and that continues. Littlejohn, I know he is the leading scorer for this Whippy team, but man, he does not shy away from the tough stuff.
CJ Kirst waiting to get the play started. 5-on-5 continues between Mountaineers and Warriors. Good first pass down low for Dudemain. Calling for it back, but it's at the other end. Ball loose. Kirst on it, gets a good shot there. Off Martin, another opportunity there for the Mountaineers. Two quick shots, two big saves. The other way, Warriors in transition now. Oldman takes the pass from Tapper. Inside the perimeter. Now outside, Riley Knox.
Delayed penalty coming up here, Inks.
6 players on the floor for the Warriors. Budway takes it. Over to McCafferty, back in the lineup tonight. Budway again, keeps it going to the right side. Back towards Knox, takes a chance. Wide of the net, lost it in traffic, and finally getting set for the first power play of the game.
Whippy will have a chance here to score the game's first goal on the power play. They averaged 1.4 power play goals a game, but they're going to be without Littlejohn. Remember, 6 seconds into the game, he's sitting down. He's a guy that is a very vital part of this man-up offense. So Gabe Cerchetti is going to be at the top, and he's a guy, Anx, that I'm looking at that will certainly have to be at his best if Whippy's going to want to make this a series and punch their ticket to the next round.
I mentioned Littlejohn's 5 points last night, 4 points for Soriketti in game one as the power play begins. Soriketti again, left to Knox. Soriketti, 3 of the 5 players getting a touch. Soriketti back to Knox. Inside, managed to get it to the other side of the zone. All the way for Knox. Loading up, Soriketti with the first shot on that power play. Mimico quickly stealing that, going the other way. Big check there by the Warriors, trying to retrieve the ball. Excellent work by Soriketti. Good pass to Langille, close enough, can't finish the play. Rolls towards Knox, though.
Couple of huge stops there from Nate Whittem.
Big 44 save performance from Whittem in that game one victory as the ball circulates among the Warriors now, loading up, inching closer. Langille, though, can't beat Whittem that time.
Couple of great chances again, though, but just Whittem standing tall, making those big saves. He was so solid yesterday, gobbling up all those outside shots. That's one thing, talking to the assistant coach, Kevin Jenkins, of this Whippy Warriors team. Said, yes, we got a lot of shots, but they weren't that many quality.
And there's a quality shot. It's CJ Kirst getting the Mountaineers on the board. 1-0 for the visitors.
CJ Kirst had a huge game last night, 5 goals, and he just uses that big frame of his, sneaky athleticism, just throws that right off the back foot. Little skipper by Martin, and I tell you, the guy is big. He's a tough check. Such a good athlete. And he's picked up this box lacrosse game pretty quickly.
Warriors start with 30 seconds on the shot clock in their favor. Little John commanding the play, of course, coming off a big performance himself in game one. Makes the pass to Soriketti to Knox. Little John to Knox again. Good fake down low to the right. Back to Little John. Takes a chance off the right side of Whittem. Rushing the corner now. A pair of Warriors against the lone Mountaineer. Getting some help, though. That was Taguri. And back behind them. Good catch of that ball by the Warriors. Knox has it. 23 seconds on their shot clock. Little John makes a pass. Nice whip at the net by the Warriors all the way around. And it'll be Mimico ball. Whittem to start the play. To Owen Lee out in front of him. From the left, cuts through. Picking up speed just outside of the perimeter. And trying to scoop that up. Get some help, though, by Thompson, who whips it at the net wide instead. Bouncing towards center, Dudemain popped it up for Waters. And back towards Mimico.
Again, Whippy, just one thing they stressed talking to the coaching staff before the game was a quick start. I know they're down 1-0 right now, Angs, but I like the pace. They're playing fast. They're not making mistakes on defense. They're getting their chances, just not executing.
Here's McCafferty back in the lineup and on the scoreboard, 1-1.
That's one way to ensure your coaches have to keep you in the lineup when you get your chances. You make the other team pay. McCafferty, just look, all that time and space. Great pick there as well. Coming from the top, Dill McGee creates just enough space for Easton McCafferty to unload that shot and beat Whittem.
Here come the Warriors again after that faceoff win. Inching closer, a bouncer away from the crease and out of play.
So we got a reset call there. I believe the trail official, Ecclestone, called it originally possession for Mimico, but Joel Furman, who was down on the crease, says no, it went off the goalie's cage.
Warriors continue, 20 seconds left on their shot clock as Budway gets it. Budway dancing around, choosing to go right, makes the pass instead. Down low to the left of Whittem, back up top. Little John takes a chance, and there's an opportunity. Good response by the Warriors. They're up 2-1 thanks to Budway.
Again, another great offensive possession. Look at Budway working hard away from the ball. He's going to set a hard pick. Shot comes from Little John. It's a great chance. Look at Budway recognizes it, keeps those feet out of the crease while picking up that loose ball and putting it home. Budway, maybe not the big name on this offense, but even last year during their Minto Cup run, he always came up with a big goal.
Great way to continue his from his three-point performance last night. Another shot from the Warriors, denied that time.
You and I were talking earlier today, and Budway's a guy that, you know, we really like his game. He's a little bit undersized, but he's a water bug. He's got a high, you know, a really high energy type of style player. You love to have those guys on your team.
Definitely showing up in the early part of this first period, less than 5 minutes into the contest. Already three goals between both teams combined. Asensa intended that for Dudemain. Bouncing around, Weller's there, scoops it, rushes from the right side. Sent it to Lee. Lee running in from the left. Connect inside. McGee can't get any closer to the net. Whittem takes it, launches it in the direction of Ethan Brown. Brown avoids the check from Lee. Good moves by the shifty Ethan Brown. Nice connection there. Thompson now trying to find a shot, steered away. Sandwich between Warriors, getting some help. Could be anyone's ball, wrestling to the floor. Thompson, though, to the top. Over to Waters now on the right side. Waters now escapes Darlison, avoids another defender. Trying to get in, draws the penalty, and the Warriors are on the penalty kill.
Going to be a high stick here. We'll get a look as Waters gets around his man, and it's not the initial trail check from McLeod. It's actually going to be Doolittle. Creeps up a little too high on the cage. This potent power play going to get to work with none other than Finn Thompson working it up top.
Finn Thompson sent it behind the net. Dudeman up top now. Nice shot there. Bounced off the boards in the direction of Lee. To Dudeman. Down low, up top to Justin Lee. Lee to Dudeman, and over the shoulder, no mistake about it. 23 seconds into the power play. It's a tie game.
You give this Mimico offense any chances on the power play, they are going to make you pay. It's a great ball movement. Nothing special here, but look at how much attention. That is an absolute snipe from Lucas Dudeman. But you could see there's so much pressure going up to the middle of the floor, but also on that far side because, of course, Finn Thompson is the facilitator. We've got a break here.
And cursed to Brennan, who tried to take the lead back. Still a tie game. Good hop on that loose ball for the Mountaineers. Taguri gives it off to Waters, and Waters moves in from the right side. He finds CJ Kirst. Kirst sidestepping, gets some space now, looking for a shot, pass instead, over to Asensa. Asensa keeping away from his defender, eats a check from Owen Lee, quick pass to Thompson, and stopped by Martin. Quick start on the left side, Doolittle, out of the box from the recent penalty. Giving it to Luke Robinson in the lineup from the Junior B Green Gales. Over to Budway. Shifting away, pushed around by Tavares, and made the pass to the right side. Back to Budway. Budway now trying from his left side, loading up, right-hand shot there, off the boards and out of play.
Great defensive stand from Mimico there, just not giving anything up to this Warriors offense, really defending the two-man game well. That's exactly what they did last night to hold the Warriors just to 6 goals.
Waters from Dudeman. Waters moves left, avoiding Hanser, takes a shot there, wide of the net. Dudeman, though, he gets it back. 10 seconds left on the Mountaineer shot clock now. Good pressure by the Warriors as Keller moving in, bounced away from that open side. Good catch now, and a whip out of play, Warriors ball.
Warriors getting lucky there, caught chasing the stick, not playing hard, two-hand, tough defense. Got to go for those cross checks. With how skilled Mimico is, you cannot be chasing stick. They're going to make you look silly.
Warriors moving around. Good moves there. Rushing in, a big chance there, and they're going to count it. Warriors, they're up 3-2.
Going to want to see the replay here. This one's mightily close. We get a chance. Nice little spin cycle moves. Balls up, down. Ooh, that one's real close. If you ask me, a beautiful effort by Dylan McGee. Nonetheless, the Ohio State Buckeye getting it done inside the box. But man, mightily close. But of course, the officials down on the floor have a better look than we do.
As the Warriors now, hot on the ball, Oldman chasing it against the boards. Good pick there by Oldman, and now to Littlejohn. Just outside for Budway, rejoining the play, continues to the right side, Littlejohn. Inside, intended for Tapper, just over him. Warriors trouble bringing that down. Brennan poking it forward, running past the benches on the left side. Brennan has Tavares with him on the right side. Makes the pass for Tavares, a little too wild for him. Tavares still caught up with that ball behind him. Now moving away from Littlejohn. Keeping away, looking for options. From the glass to the other side of the zone. Keller has it. Keller keeping away from defenders. Tavares inside tight. Good attempt there by the Mountaineers, thanks to Kirst.
Love the creativity there from Kirst.
As Darlison at center, one-handed pass to McCafferty. McCafferty inside, close enough for Langille. Four number two, they've doubled up on the Mountaineers.
Langille putting away the scraps. This is a little bit of an unsettled situation. You can see Mimico trying to figure out who are they picking up on defense, but somehow the big body of Langille is left wide open. McCafferty finds him in the middle. If you give that much time and space to a sharpshooter like Langille, he's probably gonna put that in the back of the cage.
Four goals in favor of Mimico in the first period last night in game one. This time it's four goals within the first period so far for the Whitby Warriors.
That's what Ontario Junior Lacrosse League playoffs is all about, man. The swings, it's a game of runs. The emotions run high.
Look for the response from the Mountaineers as they have possession right now, moving in. Curse, there it is! But they're going to negate that goal, Pat.
Yeah, gonna call that a crease violation.
Warriors the other way instead, trying to capitalize on that goal subtracted from the Mountaineers. Little John for Budway across the zone. Good move there by the Warriors, inching closer and can't beat Whittem that time. Quick pass to his left side. Soriketti though steals it away. 30 seconds on the shot clock for the Warriors. Waiting for players to arrive. Just outside the zone for Littlejohn. Back to Soriketti. Keeping away from Ethan Brown. He finds Budway instead. Littlejohn again trying to sneak one in to the left side of Whittem there. Bounces back to Budway in front of Mimico bench. Takes a shot from long range and denied by Whittem again. Quick response by the Mountaineers to get the ball out. Tavares, bouncer to Begley. Begley behind the back for Dudeman. Trouble catching up to it is Dudeman as pressure from the Warriors proved too much for a moment. Dudeman though gets the possession halfway through the Mountaineer shot clock. No result yet. Thompson, he grabs it now. Pass intended for Waters. Bounces away towards the glass. Waters and White for that battle. Looks like White has it first and sends it up the floor. Four Warriors approaching Mimico zone just outside of the crease. Now underhand opportunity there from McGee. Whittem, easy pass to Hobbs, keeps it going upwards. Cursed again. On the left side, Thompson. Keeps it going. Moving in close enough for Keller now. Wide of the net, Asensa though brings it down. Final 8 seconds on the shot clock for the Mountaineers. Nice cross pass for Waters, looking for space, takes a chance as their shot clock is running out, and they make it count that time. They bring it within one.
There's a delayed penalty coming up. You see both officials' hands up, but I don't know even if they got the extra attacker on quick enough. Great chance there by Waters, but Asenza sneaks behind a couple of defenders, picks up the change, puts that one away. A great initial save from Caleb Martin, but Whippy's defense has to do a better job boxing out their men, especially a smaller framed body like Cam Asenza.
NCAA product of Colgate University as Mountaineers now back in Warriors zone. Good collection of the ball by Kirst.
Talk about Budway being a smaller size guy, but not afraid to get to the net. That's the exact same way Asenza plays, and he showed that last play.
Looking forward to more of that matchup as the game progresses. For now, ball in the left corner of Martin. Good pass over to Tavares. Tavares escapes Oldman, close enough, trying to poke it in and can't do it, just outside of the crease. Physicality to the right of Martin also picking up there. Meanwhile, Warriors grab the ball and run it in from the left side. It's Ben Cromer, stops as far as Mimico's zone, left it for Littlejohn to look after. On the right side for Robinson. Keeps it going for Soriketti now. Soriketti moving away from Billing. Good speed from Soriketti. Goes left, instead goes right now. In the direction of McCafferty. Trouble picking that up. from the other number 25 on the floor, that being Brown. Brown eats the check and a pile up in front of the timekeeper there. And this is what I said a moment ago, Pat, the physicality is picking up.
Yeah, Cole Bagley did not like that extra shove while the ball was down on the floor from Lucas Littlejohn again. Littlejohn not afraid to mix things up. He plays with an edge, sometimes plays over that edge, but you would much rather have to rein a guy in than try to work him up. He is such a special player, was a big part of the reason why this team won a Minto Cup last season.
Dude him in for now for the Mountaineers, looking for space. Takes a chance there off the left side of Martin, redirected the other way. Ball bouncing around, a trio of Warriors, a pair of Mountaineers. Moran Weeks now trying to find some space and takes a check, draws a penalty as well.
Looks like that's going to be Owen Tapper who gets the gate, throwing that forearm or elbow. We'll see what the call is down on the floor. It's going to be a five for an elbow. Something the OJLL over the last couple of seasons said they wanted to really clean up is those headshots. And we're going to see a 5 minute. Man, this is something that could completely change the momentum of this game.
We have seen special teams at work for both sides so far in this game, but I think you might be right, Pat. Depends how Finn Thompson and the Mountaineers get things started in just a moment. Thompson to Keller, and Thompson continues to the right side now. Dudeman gets that back from Waters. Thompson again, four of the five players on the floor with a touch for the ball, sending it across, or at least they tried to, interrupted instead by the penalty kill. Hustling forward towards the net, good opportunity by Darlison. Couldn't beat Whittem that time. Power play continues, just 24 seconds into their 5 minute major power play without a result so far. Waters connects with Thompson. Thompson keeps it going down low and gets it back. Over to Dudeman. Good back and forth between the both of them, getting Waters involved now. Waters, though, can't get that pass through. Confused for a moment. Good recovery by Keller. Keeps the possession alive. Few more seconds left. Martin, nice save. Close enough, Keller!
Jacob Keller gets his first goal of the postseason. He's got to work hard. He's the guy who initially picks up that loose ball, takes a hard bump, big stop by Martin, but again, Whitby unable to box out their men on the crease. That is at least the second, if not the third goal that Mimico has scored off a rebound. Whitby has to do a much better job picking up those rebounds.
One assist in game one, one goal in game two. That's how it goes for Keller so far, as Mountaineers still on the power play, just over a minute into their 5 minute major power play now. Dudeman returns that to Thompson. To the right for Waters this time. Fake the pass, inching closer, takes a chance off the bar and to the ceiling. Mountaineers with possession again. This time to the left of Martin. Waters, Dudeman, Thompson. Back to Thompson. As he got that back from Lee. Dudeman, Waters inside now for Thompson to finish the job. Went wide of the net. Now to the right of Martin. As Mountaineers double teaming. Doolittle in the corner there. Doolittle, though, excellent pressure from him against the tag team of Mountaineers. Mountaineers, though, with possession anyhow. Thompson has it. Dudeman. He gets it back. Waters, Dudeman stepping away from the captain, Michael White of the Warriors. Dudeman now takes a chance. Looks like that tipped off a stick and it's rolling towards the Mountaineers zone. Thompson stops it at center. And Warriors picking up the ball now. Littlejohn takes that pass easily from Soriketti. Halfway through their shot clock, as Soriketti confronted by McDonnell. Little John now, nice stretch pass inside. McGee can't beat the 5-0, trying to hop on that loose ball. Back in favor of McGee and the Warriors, but the whistle goes instead.
And the netminder, Nate Williams, going to get a penalty for slashing. So he comes out of his crease. I'm not sure if he didn't hear the whistle go, or even regardless if he heard the whistle or not. I think Joel Furman was going to call that for a slash. So we'll see right here. Great effort. There's a possession call. Well after it was blown down. So I think that's the right call there from the officials. And we'll see a little 4-on-4 action.
Justin Tavares in the box for the Mountaineers. After that recent penalty, Knox in possession, takes a chance, redirected off the boards, somewhere in his direction. Taguri, though, making life difficult. Little John takes it away, inching closer, and he shovels it in, but it's disallowed. Whittem quickly to get the play started from his left side as McIsaac carried it up. Now Thompson has it to the right side for Dudeman. Easy handoff for Kirst. One goal in this period for CJ Kirst. Almost had a second before it was taken away. Kirst now moving from his right side. Good switch there with Dudeman. Dudeman avoiding Doolittle behind him. And the ball rolling on the floor could be anyone's possession as the shot clock expired recently. Mountaineers on it first. Kirst accepts that from Dudeman. 1:23 left in the major power play given to the Mountaineers. Meanwhile, 47 seconds left. And the other penalty to Justin Tavares. Ball rolls towards Mountaineers and Thompson picking it up. Leaves it for Sorchetti and the Warriors to get started. Little John had it for a moment, returns it to Sorchetti. Sorchetti picking up his pace, ignores Brennan. Ball just outside. And nice behind the back pass. Langille trying to return that to Sorchetti. Sorchetti, though, trouble against McIsaac. Gets right back up. Across now, and trying to tap that in was Budway. Good speed by Budway. Loose ball there. McIsaac takes it, keeps it away from Langille. McDonnell hustling on the right side instead. To Thompson at center. Keeps it going to the left side for Justin Lee. Big 6-point performance for Justin Lee in game one. A continuation of that regular season finale as well against Peterborough as Finn Thompson takes it now. Moran Weeks, Thompson again. Thompson now avoids White. Good pass inside for Lee. Moran Weeks, he can't finish it as the shot clock was running out. Warriors ready to start the play. Cromer takes that pass. Retreats for a moment, makes a one-handed pass instead. Robinson. Tapper brings it inbound. Tapper keeping away from Taguri, finds McCafferty. McCafferty now shifting away, continues right. Sorchetti now escapes his man, that being Williams. Wearing number 13 for the Mountaineers, called up from the Junior B Mohawks. And play now going towards Whitby. Oldman letting things slow down as it'll be Mountaineers to begin play. Thompson, good connection. Dudeman takes a chance and makes it count. 5-4 Mountaineers.
Unfortunate break for Whitby. You kill off that 5 minute. You're able to come out it tied, but Dudeman, just too much time, too much space. We saw him absolutely sting that top left corner. This time, he brings it with a sidearm that goes across his body and beats Caleb Martin with relative ease. That Dudeman, man, he can absolutely grip it and rip it.
79 points in the regular season. As the Warriors now moving in, looking for a response. Oldman wide of the net as it bounces in the direction of that Mimico bench. Looks like McDonnell to pick it up and get it started. to Justin Lee, to CJ Kirst. Kirst down low. As Dudeman now returns it to Kirst. Kirst now gets around Weller, and he makes it count. His second of the period, 6-4 Mountaineers.
Big goal from the big red. CJ Kirst is such a tough check. Look, uses that big body once again. Weller thinks he's going to lean into him. Instead, he throws the face dodge, goes down the alley, and he doesn't panic. Waits, then throws that across the body in the back of the net. Such a fun player to watch is CJ Kirst.
Here he comes again, now inside, close enough. Thompson looking for his first of the game. There it is.
Right off the faceoff, Kirst. Great battle. Picks up the loose ball. No one slides to him, but somehow Thompson able to find some real estate. That is just a goal scorer's goal. Finn Thompson, you weren't going to keep him off the score sheet for that long. An absolute beauty from the man who's put up 130 plus points in two consecutive seasons.
Quick succession of three goals from the Mountaineers. And here they come again. Brennan now to the other side. Thompson looking for his second of the period. Hard to believe that the Mountaineers had posted six goals before Thompson finally got on the scoreboard himself, Pat.
It's quite remarkable. It wasn't for a lack of chances, just not able to make those bounces go. But again, Whippy did a pretty good job limiting the time and space. Just sometimes good players find ways to make their impact felt.
Final minute of the period, Budway accepts that pass from Langeal. Budway shifting around to the top of the slot now, off the left pad, ball available, Soraketti denied. But it seems he drew a penalty instead, as I see Ethan Brown called for holding and redirected towards the penalty box.
You're exactly right, so Whippy gonna get a great opportunity. You'll see the extra hand just pulled right there, enough on Little John to see Andrew Ecclestone, but another opportunity there for Soraketti to score off the rebound. But with under a minute, Whippy's gonna have a chance here to, you know, cut into this lead.
Ball circulated, all five players finally have a touch of it, less than 10 seconds into that power play. Knox now continues it low, behind the net, up top, Little John inside for Budway. Soraketti steered away as well. Whittem with the advantage to pick that up, look for options, and turns it over right in front, close enough, trying to make them pay, Langeal. But Whittem, sharp on the ball, tries again, this time over to Taguri. Moves it up to center. Taguri to Kirst. Kirst, though, pushed off the ball.
Over and back violation, so Whippy's going to get possession and not wasting any time as Mitch Wild calls the timeout. So Kevin Jenkins, the offensive coordinator, has the clipboard out. Going to draw something up here with 11.2 seconds remaining in this first period. We'll see, is this CJ Kirst, just a great job. Look at the little twister. Finds Thompson and puts that right in the back of the net. CJ Kirst from New Jersey, but you would think this kid has been playing box lacrosse indoors his entire life. One of the many players who've taken their talent north of the border this summer to play in the OJ. He's been such a treat to watch.
Back-to-back games without a goal that followed that was followed by his first career hat trick, spurred a seven-game point streak, 23 points in that span, 11 assists in his recent five regular season games played. That's the story of CJ Kirst.
A family of lacrosse players.
Not to mention, you called him Big Red a moment ago as well. 65 goals in his NCAA junior season as well. That's a record for Cornell University. What a treat for us to watch him in the OJLL this summer. As for now, the Warriors have the ball as a shot taken by Little John off the bar. Right to Soraketti now, avoiding Brennan. Soraketti across the zone, a little too wild for Knox, and Budway, possession to Mimico. But that'll be it, as the first 20 minutes of game two are complete. 7-4, Mountaineers lead the Warriors. You're watching the OJLL on YouTube. We'll be back after the first intermission.
On our family dairy farm, there's a saying that the sun doesn't start the day, we do. It's our daily reminder to be our best, make our best. And that our dairy farm doesn't just take care of our family, it's part of something bigger. That's dairy done right.
Gatorade. With electrolytes to help replenish what's lost in sweat. Carbs to help fuel your working muscles. And fluids to help you hydrate. Rehydrate, replenish, refuel. Scientifically formulated so you never stop competing. Gatorade.
back at Iroquois Park, where the Mountaineers lead 7-4 after 20 minutes of regulation. Angst Kumar alongside Pat Gregoire getting you ready for the second period in just a few moments. 11 goals combined in the opening 20 minutes of regulation, Pat.
A big explosion of offense for both these teams, but when you look at it, this was essentially a 4-4 game until a 20-second run of three goals by the Mimico Mountaineers just blew this game up. And of course, it's still a three-goal lead, which is next to nothing in the game of lacrosse, but it just seemed like it was snowballing for Whitby. They got to get back to playing fast on both sides of the ball. Don't worry about that run. It was a tied game. On the flip side, Mimico, use those runs to your advantage. Try to get Finn Thompson going. He had just one goal and two assists, which nothing to shake a stick at, but nonetheless, you got to get him going. He is the heartbeat of this offense, but CJ Kurth really taking over the game early on. Two goals and two assists.
Second period officially underway. Warriors have 30 seconds of the shot clock in their favor to begin this new period. As Mountaineers shorthanded, penalty from the previous period. Good advantage for the Warriors as Langille has it. Thought about going down low, instead found Little John across Sorchetti in the direction of Budway. A little too wild for him. Mountaineers hot on it. There's Aaron Taguri now alongside Ben McIsaac. 2-on-1 forming. Nice connection. McIsaac with the first shot of the period for the Mountaineers. The other way, Sorchetti goes. Stops on his right side. Passes it over McIsaac. Finds his man, that being Knox. Knox gets that back from Budway, now to Langille, across, loading up, Little John underhand and off the board in possession of the Mountaineers now. Whittem over to McDonnell, brings it down, keeping it away from Cromer as he moves towards his bench. Good pass inside. Kirst stepping away from a trio of Warriors. Hangs on to that possession, even though play got a little aggressive against him. Justin Lee has it now, trying to move in on the right side. Darlison pushes him away, as does Doolittle. Lee catching up to the ball, pops it up, and Whitby with possession. Darlison from the right side, confronted by Tavares. Fake the pass, hung on to the ball. Good move against Tavares, and finds the man he wants instead down low. Comes back to Little John. Langille. Inside now, outside now, rather, for Darlison. Loads up, takes a chance. Ball available. Good aggressiveness from Langille and the Warriors. Catching up to the ball again. Trouble for the Mountaineers. They finally scoop it. Hobbs sends it forward and just out of reach for Tavares.
A great job by Whippy's offense to put pressure on Mimico's defense. You don't get the ball in the loose ball battle, but you eventually get it with that second violation, not getting it over the run line.
Langille and the Warriors now, another opportunity. Wide of the net, comes back though to Little John. He takes a chance underhand, and wide of the left post from Whittem. Williams to start the play. Mentioned it in the first period that he's from the Junior B Mohawks program. Part of the Mountaineers as he's dealing with Cromer now. Spins away from Cromer. Good move there, but it's Whitby ball.
Once again, another 8-second violation. This is something that when Whitby went on that run to the Minto Cup last year, that was their bread and butter. Being fast on both sides, having a strong forecheck, and it seems to be working early in the second period here.
Little John now with an opportunity, couldn't meet the net. Brown takes that and runs the other way. Has Brennan with him. Stops on the left side, retreats for a moment, looking at his options. Commanding the play, good move by Brown as he gets away from McGee and Tapper. Finds a man inside. And play keeps going as Kirst moves it to Dudeman. Now to Waters, loading up. Pushes through instead. Getting close now and can't beat Martin. Good for Kirst. Hops on that loose ball behind the net. Fresh 30 seconds, Mountaineers. Keller across the zone for Dudeman. Back in the direction of Thompson. Thompson, pass a little too high off the glass. Now over to the right of Martin. Good hop on that ball by Keller. Kirst loads up off the left pad of Martin. And straight to the Warriors, hustling out of the zone. Owen Lee has Luke Robinson with him. They're charging the net, taking a chance wide of the net. Budway, though, recovers. McGee with a chance off the right side of Whittem. The other way now. Kirsch trying to get away from his defender. Good speed, though, by the Warriors. Causing pressure at center. Budway against Kirsch. Nonetheless, inside for Asenzo. Over to the right side, Dudeman. Nice pass, Thompson now for the finish. Couldn't get it that time. Ball rolls in the direction of Whittem. Leaves it for Darlison and the Warriors. New 30 seconds on the shot clock for the Warriors as Darlison has it. Pulled away, Little John continues left. Knox now back to Soriketti. Soriketti now avoiding Brown. Good battle between the two. Good footwork against each other. Now Darlison now ready to take a shot. Play going the other way.
Just a little bit too much spice on that pick there. Going to call it an illegal screen. So Mimico. It's going to be an illegal substitution for Mimico. So a sloppy change there. Going to actually cost them not only possession but a man advantage opportunity for Whitby.
Good momentum from the Mountaineers to get that play started as Owen Hobbs had an opportunity to bring the play inbound. Warriors getting set for their power play. It looks like it'll be Asenza in the penalty box. Little John has it to start. Pass to his left. Comes back to Knox. Soriketti. All five players have a touch of it. 10 seconds into the power play. Now behind the net. Out front now, Little John. And for Budway. Budway lost track of it. And it rolls towards Whitby bench. Good scoop there by Knox. Knox, nice high pass. Good connection for Budway. Bounces in the direction of the Warriors. The shot clock expires. Mountaineers with possession now. Off and running on the left side. Brennan now moving in, has Dudeman moving to the net just out of his reach. Whitby though snags that down the other way. Little John commanding the play. Makes the pass close enough. Soriketti couldn't finish it off the bar. Popped right up though, back to Little John. Slowing things down as they reset in the offensive zone. Short pass to his left, Knox to Soriketti. Langille, Soriketti, Knox. Finally, all five players get a touch of it once again. Close enough to Whittem now. Shot taken there. Langille trying to hop on that loose ball after that shot to get another 30 seconds. Didn't work that time.
Back in inside the crease. So Whitby going to stay with possession. Probably will be their last offensive possession on this power play. A ton of chances, just not able to convert.
Half a minute left on the power play as Soriketti takes a chance. Langille on the ball. Back to Soriketti. To his left, Little John. Keeps it going on the left side. Takes that pass, underhand opportunity, couldn't meet the net. Budway jumping on it again. Halfway through the shot clock. Final 11 seconds on the power play. Little John takes a chance again, can't meet the net. Looks like McDonnell interrupted that. Soriketti now trying to move close enough. And back to 5-on-5, while a new 30 seconds on the shot clock belonged to Whitby in Mimico zone. Ball bouncing towards the board, Langille versus McDonnell. He wins the battle over to McIsaac. Upwards, Asenza from McIsaac. Keeping away from Oldman. Good pressure by Oldman, better possession. From Asenza now moving in. Good connection for Justin Lee. And they double up on the Warriors, 8-4.
This all comes from the hard work of Asenza. He gets back, comes out of the penalty box, beats his man, takes it to the net. Could have easily taken that shot, but he sees Lee, who has a hot stick so far in this postseason, fires it over to him into the back of the net. Justin Lee, one goal and six assists last night, was the distributor, but with a shot like that, no doubt showing off his goal scoring ability.
Play resumes as Brennan picks it up. Only for a moment, lost it, picked it up again, and rushing to the net this time, and takes a chance. Off the net, to the left of Martin. Tavares picks it up, and running away from the other two Warriors, confronted by a third Warrior, that being Tapper now. Manages to hang on to the ball. White, though, stole it away from him. White moving it forward. And comes back to the right side. Tapper now. Nice connection. The stretch for Budway, but he can't beat Whittem that time. Begley on the left side. Spins away from Tapper. Pulls ahead of Tapper for a moment. To Kirsch just outside of Warrior zone. Talib rejoining the play. Most recent goal scorer for the Mountaineers. Now Kirsch! His hat trick! That's his third of the game!
This is why this offense for Mimico is so deadly. Just any night, one of these guys can go off. A great fake from the American. Great fake, great take. Inside feed was great too. But any of these guys, it could be Thompson, it could be Lee, it could be Moran Weeks or Kirst. All these guys have the ability to take over a game. Well, here tonight, it's been Kirst who has been absolutely dominant. And oh yeah, he's been great at the faceoff too.
Especially against Jack Oldman, not an easy competitor in the faceoff circle. Mountaineers though, keeping up with the play. Having spoke with head coach Dean George earlier tonight, this is exactly what he wanted to see, a little more effort from the committee side of things and having Clear step up. And speaking of stepping up, Darlison with a chance there, took a shot, met the ceiling instead. McDonnell to start it on the left side.
Second periods certainly have not been friendly for Whitby so far. Last night, not only being outscored 5-0, but also gave up 30 shots against.
Thompson now inside for Moran Weeks, and they'll count it. Double digits for the Mountaineers, thanks to Isaiah Moran Weeks.
Moran Weeks, the pride and the pee in Ontario, scores in his office. He's just so sneaky, gets behind the net. We've seen him score this goal, whether he's playing for Nepean Junior B or up here with the Mimico Mountaineers. Just goes behind the net, sneaks by the defender, and I think we're getting a goaltender change as Caleb Martin is going to lead this game, and in comes Ethan Harwood.
From the Junior C Whitby Warriors program. Called up for the Junior A Whitby Warriors. Oldman and Kirst getting reset for the face-off.
It looks like Caleb Martin went all the way down the hall and over to the dressing room. I'm not sure if he's just frustrated right now, but the trainer did follow him, so that's something we're going to have to pay attention to.
Warriors with possession for now. Starts with Oldman to Weller. Weller back to his left side. Little John to Tapper. Tapper moving away from the captain, Finn Thompson, avoiding Kirst as well. Finds a pass inside, close enough, Soraketti!
You're not going to be able to write this one up much better. Look at the great off-ball move. Look at the two-man game. Soraketti crashing, banging. Tapper gets it to the far crease and quickly in and out of the stick. Goes Soraketti, scores his first goal of the game. He is certainly going to be, have to be, I should say, a catalyst if not only Whitby wants to come back and win this game, but if Whitby wants any sort of chance to win this series.
And their advantage might continue, Pat. They're going on the power play. Aaron Taguri, or so I thought, looks like it could be offsetting. I saw Aaron Taguri make his way to the box first. Lucas Littlejohn approaches the penalty box for his respective side, a lot more frustrated.
Looks like unsportsmanlike, according to Mac Abbott. And those are the same two customers who 6 seconds into the game found themselves a roughing penalty this time. So we're going to stay 5-on-5, but again, no knock against Tagore's game. He's an outstanding defender, but that's a trade-off that you probably want. You get Little John off the floor for 2 minutes.
For now, Lee has it to Waters. Waters avoiding Old Mint, takes a chance, wide of the net now, and Thompson takes another opportunity there. Tapper steals that ball, hustling out of the zone on the right side. Passed it forward, Soriketti, recent goal scorer, to cut this lead in half for the Warriors. Tapper again, continues down low for McGee. Mountaineers with possession now, quickly picking up that ball. Hobbs to the right side, Dudeman across the zone. Brown retreats. Good move by Brown as he avoids Cromer. Made the pass over to Senza across the zone. Keller down low for Waters. Waters to Dudeman now. Dudeman going to the top now, takes a chance, wide of the net. Trap behind the net, quickly picked up by the Warriors. Cromer from the right side, accepts it. Brings it in slowly. Good connection there with Soriketti. Soriketti now close enough for Langille. Out of his reach though. Popped out in front anyhow. Mountaineers quickly pull that one away. Trying to move it forward for Begley. He wasn't aware for a moment. Oldman capitalizes and moves ahead on the right side. Soriketti right behind him. Across the zone, Langille. Good handoff. Or so it seemed, as Langille returns it to Soriketti. Soriketti now pulling away from Begley, moving in, trying to tuck one in, and a good drag and collection of the ball, but it looks like a penalty coming up to the Mountaineers.
I think that's going to be Aiden McDonnell, who's going to sit down, one of the tough defenders for this Mimico team. So that's Tagore and McDonnell. So Whitby with a great opportunity. We'll see the penalty here. You see off to the left side, a healthy shot to the face, which official Joel Furman had no interest in that. So he's going to sit down for 2 minutes or less.
Knox has it for Soriketti. Returns that to Knox. Soriketti got it back. Another pass to Knox. Soriketti, good trade-off, getting Langille involved as well. And Budway, too, couldn't beat Whittam that time.
I think that might have went off the far pipe, actually. A couple of chances for this Whippy power play, just not able to Harwood. Beat Nate Whittam.
Harwood to Knox, now Soriketti and Langille. All five players, as well as the goaltender, have a touch of the ball as Langille continues play, gets it back from Robinson, can't find a window to shoot, gets it back. Now he'll take a shot right at the crest of Whittam, quickly collects that, and sends it high. Good connection there, Brennan keeps it going on the left side. Brennan for Thompson, joining the play. Thompson behind the back for Dudeman. Catches up to it, right in front of the boards. Curse, good move there. Hangs on to possession. And now inside for Dudeman, can't tuck it past Harwood. Sends it forward for Oldman. 30 seconds left in the Mountaineers penalty. Knox down low, he gets it back from Budway to Soriketti. Knox again, Soriketti, good trade between the two, sharing the ball. Knox will be the one to take a chance and denied by Whittam. Final 3 seconds on the power play, but a fresh 30 seconds for Williams and the Mountaineers.
Great penalty kill from the Mountaineers, and the old adage goes, sometimes your best penalty killer is your goaltender. That certainly was the case. That last PK, he was lights out, 24 saves on the evening.
Owen Lee hustling away from the other Lee on the floor, that being Justin Lee. To the left side for McCafferty to Budway, pulling away, and to the right side, here's McGee now. One goal earlier this evening for Dylan McGee as he escapes. Finn Thompson looking to get away from Hobbs as well. Fake to pass, hung on to possession, final second of it, took the shot and rolls in favor of Whitby. Another 30 seconds on the shot clock, this time a delayed penalty too.
It's gonna be a pair of Mountaineers sitting down as Finn Thompson and Cole Begley, I think one was a slash, the other an illegal cross check. We'll take a look here. There's the slash from Thompson. And you can see in the far corner there, there's the reset. I think the additional, that's the illegal cross check, goes right on the hip of, I think, McCafferty, but nonetheless, Thompson and Begley gonna be sitting down.
Three penalties for Cole Begley in last night's contest, and one of them resulted in a power play goal for the Whitby Warriors. This is perhaps the exact situation they were hoping for. One of the more physical players, Cole Begley, that they want off the floor. See how Whitby responds as they begin their power play. Knox, down low for Budway, quick pass over to Langille, and went right behind him. Sorchetti retrieves that. Gets it back from Knox. Inside for Budway, no mistake about it. And they trail 10-6.
At this level, man, the two-man advantage is almost automatic. Look what Mimico, three men on the floor. You gotta respect Sorchetti because he's got a cannon from the outside. They cheat out to just enough of him, gives enough of a window for Sorchetti to make that beautiful skip pass to the back door. And Whippy's best crease player, Budway, makes no mistake. Makes this a 10-6 game, and right away, Whippy back on the man advantage, this time a 5-on-4.
3 points in game one, and his offensive success continues tonight as the Warriors, now with a 5-on-4, Sorchetti has it to the right side. Gets that back, goes left instead. Knox inside, underhand attempt there for Langille. McIsaac in his direction, out of his reach. Sorchetti capitalizes and takes that ball. 30 seconds of possession on the shot clock for the Warriors. Over to the left side as Knox rejoins the play. Sorchetti down low. Comes back to Sorchetti. Sharing the ball. On the right side, back to Sorchetti, loading up and stopped by Whittem. Whittem now, quick pass, high over everyone, connects with McDonnell. McDonnell hustling on the left side, avoiding Hanser. McIsaac now, almost didn't get that pass through as Cromer's stick was in the way. Good connection anyhow. Mimico having some trouble. Cursed having to deal with Oldman. Great one-on-one battle, whether it's against each other in the offensive play or at center at the faceoff. Curse now with a chance, and it rolls in the direction of the Warriors, and they're off and running. Here are the Warriors. Weller alone against Whittem, making some moves. Denied by Whittem, though. At the boards, collected quick. It's McIsaac taking momentum the other way.
Great chance from the big body Weller. Big team guy, a guy that doesn't normally get those opportunities. More of a stay-at-home defender. Would have given such a boost of energy and momentum to Whitby if he scores there.
Nice shot by Lee, but stopped by Harwood. And now bouncing in the direction of Darlison. He collects it quick and goes for the shot. Nice stop there by Whittem, trying to trap that ball. Pulls it back. Gets the fresh 30 seconds of possession started for the Mountaineers.
No looker by Darlison, a really skilled player there from one of their transition standouts. Unfortunately for him, it was an even better save from Whittem, who I think bit on the fake, but was smart enough to keep that stick there just in case he went with the shot for the five hole.
Dudeman pulls it away from the boards, avoids Doolittle. Bouncer to the other side of the zone, and 30 seconds of shot clock now belongs to Owen Lee and the Warriors. He connects with Tapper rushing in, trying to tuck one in, and no success there. Warriors, though, quickly on it again. McGee takes it from Tapper. Rather Soriketti. Now to the other side of the zone there, McCafferty. Moving in now and sliding in for a shot, no luck. Warriors desperate on it, good recovery by the Warriors. Langille! Overhand and brings it within three!
We saw Mimico go on a run in the first. They went on a run in the second. Well, now it's time for the Warriors to get on their run. And once again, the second time this game, Langille finds himself completely wide open. This guy's got an absolute hammer from the outside. Makes no mistake. And beats Whittam in between the wickets for his second goal of the game.
What started out as a 7-4 second period, it's 10-7 in favor of Mimico for now, but 3-3 is a second period score. Whitby with a great response against the visitors so far. Meanwhile, Mountaineers with possession right now. As Kirst had it for a moment. Trouble against the Warriors, finds Dudeman. Over to Thompson, Wild behind him, rolls over to Harwood. Harwood sends it forward as Owen Lee picking up the pace now, takes a chance and rolls in the direction of Darlison, but he couldn't do anything. And Whittam grabs it over to the captain, Finn Thompson. Keeping away from Cromer, finds Waters as he joins the play. Waters loads up, takes a chance off of Harwood in the left corner. A pair of Warriors against the lone Mountaineer. Somehow got that pass through, and Lee takes a chance anyhow. Denied by Harwood.
Harwood's been quite sharp since coming into this game.
From the net outward, yeah. It seems like the momentum has carried. Defensively, they've looked sharp. Offensively, they've kept up with the play much better than most might have anticipated at the start of the period. Within three goals now. Here in game two, looking to even the series. 1-0 Mountaineers lead after 11-6 victory last night. And a shot there, McCafferty can't do much else though.
And I think if you're a Whippy Warriors fan, and don't hit the panic button, we saw Caleb Martin and Liam Wright last year on that Minto Cup run juggle back and forth. There really wasn't a quote-unquote starting goalie until that final series, and really until the Minto Cup started, and that's when Caleb Martin played his best lacrosse of the season.
Kirst to Dudeman, goes underhand, wide of the net, rolls in the direction of Keller. He's confronted by a trio of Warriors, didn't get the shot he wanted, had to take a chance as the clock was running out.
Bring up a great point. Since the goaltending change, it's been a much tighter defensive effort from Whitby, but they're still taking chances in transition.
Final minute of the second period, and a chance for Budway now, rolling in the direction of Robinson. Budway, good recovery to Knox. Soriketti on the right side now. Soriketti keeping away from his defender. Good connection for Budway, makes the pass over to Langille. A little unaware, nonetheless, Robinson has it now, halfway through the shot clock. No result yet. Loose ball, picked up by the Mountaineers. Big check in the low left corner. Loose ball there. Now Soriketti trying to pick up on it. And Mac Donnell, Moran Weeks, everybody has something to say about game two, Pat.
Couple cage grabs as well. We're going to see multiple players, I think, sitting down for two. As we now see a few Whitby Warriors. Lucas Billing from Mimico going to sit down as well. Taguri and Little John, their penalties now are able to be released. So good news for Warriors. Bad news for the Warriors. Three red jerseys head to the box, and it looks like maybe only two for Mimico. As you see all the rough stuff come here. Good luck to the officials trying to figure out what's going on here. But I think just based off the bodies that we see in the box, as the two captains, Thompson and White, come over, try to figure what's going on, the officials are going to have a chat about this first. Keep in mind there was an initial penalty before the scrum ensued, so I assume that's where that one penalty is going to come initially, and that's where the extras then ensued after. So Thompson and White get the explanation. Five on four, Mimico going to have the advantage. High stick and a bunch of roughs. Easy way to break it down.
Four roughing calls out of the five penalties assessed as Mimico begins the final half minute of the second period with possession. Dudeman has it. Gets it back behind the net. Thompson out front now, Waters. Thompson inside, close enough. Couldn't quite finish that time. Hardwood now, quick pass over to Tapper on the right side. Final possession could belong to Whitby. They take a chance as the second period begins to run out. Whitham confused for a moment. Good pickup of the ball. And that'll do it for the second period. Despite a three-goal difference, a lot tighter of a period. Three goals from the Mountaineers. Three goals from the Warriors. Final 20 minutes of regulation coming up after the second intermission. You're watching the OJLL playoffs on YouTube.
Family Dairy Farm, there's a saying that the sun doesn't start the day, we do. It's our daily reminder to be our best, make our best, and that our dairy farm doesn't just take care of our family, it's part of something bigger. That's dairy done right.
Gatorade. With electrolytes to help replenish what's lost in sweat. Carbs to help fuel your working muscles. And fluids to help you hydrate. Rehydrate, replenish, refuel. Scientifically formulated so you never stop competing. Gatorade.
moments away from the final 20 minutes of a regulation. Third period set to begin, a 10-7 lead for the Mountaineers. Angst Kumar alongside Pat Gregoire, live from Iroquois Park. An exciting second period. It was full of penalties, but I love the goal scoring, but it seems like the rough stuff dominated that one. We'll see what the Warriors and Mountaineers come back with after the second intermission. Third period officially underway as Oldman goes for a run around the net. Eats a check from Taguri. Ball stripped away from him. First to Tavares. Goes on his right side. Tavares now takes a stick from Captain Michael White. Makes the pass to Finn Thompson. Now to Dudeman. Waters on the right side. Returns that to Dudeman. Goes left this time. Lee, Dudeman, Waters for Moran Weeks. Waters again loading up. Takes a chance there and right to the Warriors. Over to the boards. Running through. Excellent speed there by Hanser. Gets past two Mountaineers, especially Waters there. Lost the ball behind him. Little John recovered it for the Warriors.
You love seeing that. Kobe Hanser blocks the shot, soaks one, then picks up the ball, runs it to safe space. Those little hustle plays from your defenders go a long way to help inject some life into the offense.
Shot went wide from Little John. Mountaineers, Williams over to Waters quickly. Now to Dudeman as he joins the floor. Along with Lee, Moran Weeks, and Thompson. Moran Weeks on his right. Returned that to Dudeman. This time goes left to Thompson. Dudeman again, no look pass to Thompson. Takes a chance there off of Harwood. Thompson again, across everyone to Waters. Down low for Moran Weeks. Thompson gets it close enough. No one available to finish it. Loose ball available. Warriors take that. And along the left side. Running hard there. Stops in his tracks as Weller, keeping away from Dudeman. All the way to center now. Good connection with Littlejohn as he rejoins the play. Halfway through the shot clock, over to Robinson. Robinson went down low. Moves closer to the net now. McCafferty, Littlejohn. Littlejohn pulling away from the play. Now he speeds up a little bit. Takes an underhand chance off the leg of McIsaac. Rolled over to Whittem anyhow. Launches it over everyone. And has the Warriors going back for it. Rolls past the penalty boxes. Langille and Budway in the box for the Warriors, while Brown and Billing for the Mountaineers. A collection of penalties from the previous period. Little John, good connection there with Darlison. Tried it forward for Knox. And now Hobbs picks it up. And looks like a continuation of last night as Cole Begley seems to find another Whitby Warrior he doesn't want to get along with. Jack Budway in first period of game one. Lucas Littlejohn in period three of game one. And now it's Riley Knox.
And it's just going to be Begley who's going to sit down. We'll see if it is just 2 minutes or if there's anything extra. But just going to be a two for rough as Joel Furman sits Begley down for, I think, his third penalty of the game. You talked about it. This is a guy that loves playing with edge. He's a tough customer, but sometimes crosses that line. That certainly was the case here. He wasn't even able to take Riley Knox with him. So the Warriors going to have an opportunity now to cut this lead to just two, try to get that momentum back on their side.
Similar to third period of game one, where Begley took a penalty. And Little John scored a power play goal, a bit of poetic justice, as Little John was the victim of Begley's actions. Let's see how they respond as everybody gets a touch of the ball. McCafferty keeps it going to the left. Looks like around the world, all around that net. Finally a shot taken, bounces in the direction of Little John. Good collection there as he snags the ball away from McIsaac. Gets it back from Soriketti. Soriketti gets it to Little John, who takes a chance overhand, and Whittem, big save there, a necessary save as well. 40 seconds into Whitby's power play, no result on the man advantage. Curse with the advantage of the shot clock on the side of the Mountaineers. Halfway through the shot clock, no shot yet. Curse now spinning away, trying to get closer to the play. Good diversion from the Warriors, though, making his life difficult. Didn't get that shot he wanted.
I think it was the right take, just not the right execution. But that's just a pure field lacrosse play. Turns on a dime, throws the spin cycle, a little bit of a fadeaway shot. Probably in a bigger net in the field game. That one probably sinks, but he's finding out early in his young junior career. This box game's not easy to score from outside.
47 seconds left on their power play. Warriors, clever move there by Soriketti behind the back. Couldn't meet the net though. And a drawn penalty by the Mountaineers.
Great behind the back chance by Soriketti. We'll see the high stick comes up right there underneath the chin. The Mountaineers player, I believe, that's Aaron Taguri. So we're going to stay 4-on-4 lacrosse for 40 seconds.
Mountaineers have 30 seconds of the shot clock on their side. Curse to begin the play. Keeping away from the old man. Handles the ball excellently to Dudeman. Now underhand off of Harwood to his left side. Speeding towards the ball. Kirsch trying to get it. Dudeman, though, picks it up instead. Kirsch has it. Final 10 seconds on Mimico's penalty before they get a power play for a minute 20. Begley ready to rejoin the play. Rushes to the bench as Moran Weeks steps in, and the power play picks up. Excellently done. Justin Lee, his second of the game.
Lee was the distributor last night, but he's showing off that if you give him too much time and space, and look, all the attention's on Thompson, who no doubt is the heartbeat of this offense. But Lee has proven in this series, if you give him enough space, he's gonna make you pay with that outside shot. Gonna get a little bit of a wipe down on the floor. I think there's a couple of sweaty spots on the floor, as anyone who's been to a game at IPA certainly knows. And it also looks like there's going to be a penalty coming up for the Warriors. Might be a bench minor, perhaps.
We'll see in just a moment. I did see Mac Abbott signal towards the timekeeper. And to confirm your hunch, it is a 5-on-4 for the Mountaineers. 11-7 lead, 15:09 left in the third period of game two. Mountaineers already leading the series 1-0 following their 11-6 victory at Mimico Arena. Warriors looking to even the series on their home floor tonight. Thompson faked the pass. Nice behind the back move there to Lee. 4 points after his most recent goal in this contest. Dudeman to his left side, quickly back from Thompson. Thompson again. Over to Dudeman. Doolittle, trouble picking it up. And finally, good recovery there and pushed forward by the Warriors. Tapper, though, couldn't get it much further ahead. Picked up quick, Soriketti as he rejoins the floor. Over to McGee. McGee getting some help from Little John to create a diversion. Trying to get away from Taguri. Pulls away from Taguri, looking for the man moving in. Little John rushes in! Big shorthanded goal for the home team.
Nothing small about Little John's game. The guy just comes up with big goals. Great backdoor cut. Beats his man quickly in and out of the stick before the slide from McDonald can come. But a great find from Dylan McGee, the Texas-born player for this Warriors team. His dad played for Brooklyn, Senior A here. And Taguri, once again, drawing another penalty. Done a great job all series long. Mimico tried the hidden ball trick, but Whitby not buying that at all.
45 seconds still on their first power play. Shot taken there. And now we'll see Altman joining Luke Robinson in the penalty box.
So 38 seconds remaining in that initial penalty to Robinson, the bench minor.
Recovered by the Mountaineers, doing them into Thompson. Moran Weeks couldn't finish that, and it bounces high, brought down by the Warriors. Picking up speed, Tapper rushing through, passes Keller behind the back. Good collection by McGee. As he zooms into the zone, turns away from Billing, takes a chance there, wide of the net. Bouncing though in the direction of Brennan, he picks it up first, away from Sorchetti. In the middle of the Mimico defensive zone, Thompson now confronted by Robinson, who just stepped on the floor, 5-on-4 for a minute 15, continues for the Mountaineers. Lee looking for options, chose Thompson, continues to the right side, Dudeman returns that to Thompson, pulls away, takes a chance overhand, and meets the mesh.
Great job by Whippy to collapse on Thompson, get that stick on him.
Kobe Hanser runs as far as Mimico's zone to Little John, behind him for McGee. McGee running past Brennan, trying to cut in and finish the play himself. Can't do it that time. McDonnell quickly on the right side, and more penalties.
The parade to the sit bin continues for both these sides. Not a lot getting by these officials tonight. Trying to call it early and often this time. It's going to be a rough. I thought it was.
Did you think it might have been Finn Thompson?
No,
he was walking towards the box, and then he retreated towards the bench. I think they're getting it sorted out.
We'll see the replay here. It looks like it's going to be Tavares who heads to the bench. Unfortunately, the play is here. And where our camera was situated following the ball, so it was behind the play. So, although I don't recall seeing Tavares on the floor, so this might be some gamesmanship. The official's not arguing that perhaps the wrong player went to the penalty box. But nonetheless, going to be 4-on-4 for 40 seconds once again. And with how much skill is on both sides of the ball, you are in for a treat when you go 4-on-4. With all the great stick handlers, the great athletes, it just provides a great product of lacrosse. Two-man games all over the floor.
As speed picks up for McGee now, can't beat Whittem that time, Warriors. Kicking the ball behind him. Good recovery by the Warriors. McCafferty to his left side. Little John. Managed to get that through McDonnell. Collected that loose ball again. Fresh 30 seconds of possession for Sorchetti and the Warriors. Now over to Little John. Nice one-handed grab. Almost lost it behind him. Keeps the possession inbound. Overhand now. Shot taken there. No mistake about it. Dylan McGee.
Seeing McGee score in tight, now he shows off the cannon from the outside. We'll get a great look here. Look at all the time and space. This is 4-on-4 lacrosse. Takes his man wide, and before that slide could come, he lets that loose. The Ohio State Buckeye scores once again, his third of the game. And this one couldn't come at a better time.
Warriors within two. And on the power play, or rather 5-on-5. As the Mountaineers return the other way, Tavares loading up. Took a chance there, couldn't beat Harwood that time. 2-goal difference now between the Warriors and the Mountaineers. Warriors trying to even the series. For now, Littlejohn runs it in, keeping it away from Tavares. Darlison got that, continued to the right. Moving closer to the net. As Knox takes it, hustles into the play. Good chance there, and a stop by Whittem. Mountaineers starting on their left side. As Taguri had the ball, good connection with Kirst. Moves it down low for Dudeman to Kirst again. Dudeman has it, keeping away from Owen Lee. Right in front, and what a finish! It's CJ Kirst again!
I mean, every time CJ Kirst touched the floor, this is must-see TV. The guy is an absolute electric factory. Look at the hands in tight, just beating all of the stereotypes that the Americans can't finish on the inside. Well, this guy has completely embraced the box lacrosse game and has become one of the most electrifying players in the OJ.
4 goals and 7 points for CJ Kirst tonight. It was a 4-goal game in game one for Finn Thompson. Tonight, a 4-goal game for CJ Kirst on behalf of the Mountaineers. 10:25 left in regulation. Warriors looking for a response as Oldman now rushes the net, takes a chance, and he gets it! They're back within two!
Again, Sorchetti absolutely loved this about his game. Gets that cause turnover, and here comes the transition. Oldman looks, waits, takes and buries the Swiss Army knife for this Warriors team. He can take faceoffs, he'll play defense, and he'll stay and play a little bit as well. He shows off his offensive prowess to bring this back to a 2-goal game.
His first of the game and his first of the 2023 OJLL playoffs. A big one to bring this within two. And the physicality picking up once again. Delayed penalty coming against the Mountaineers. Seems like the advantages continue in favor of the Whitby Warriors, but this could be advantageous as Littlejohn took a big stick. Face level, possibly even eye level. We'll see in just a moment, but this power play could be huge, Pat, as it's CJ Kirst making his way to the box.
Absolutely massive. And yeah, he doesn't kill penalties. We'll get a look here. Cross check, then the extra one on the ground as well. So you mentioned it, CJ Kirst, yes, he doesn't kill penalties necessarily. He's not on the penalty kill, but as soon as his team gets the ball, he's one of the first guys out there ragging the ball. We saw him earlier in the game score a shorthanded goal. He is such a big part of this penalty kill unit that it is a massive, massive loss here. So if you're Whippy, you want to capitalize. You want to capitalize quickly as well. Keep the momentum going that's on your side and get this within one goal.
Well said, Pat, and plenty of time to make it happen. They are set for it. And it almost feels like deja vu every time I see this when a penalty happens in the third period and the Mountaineers are the culprit and Littlejohn happens to be the victim. He took a big stick to his face and back on the floor ready to get this power play started.
I mean, that is just one of the great things about Littlejohn's game. He's not afraid to muck it up. He is a guy that loves the physical play. The body craves contact, and that certainly is the case for Littlejohn. He's a tremendous athlete too. Buckland Cup champion with the Pickering Panthers. Played in a Canadian national tournament. Played in two Canadian national tournaments. One for provincial junior A hockey. The other one, obviously, the one that he won with this team in the Minto Cup. Dude is a freak athlete. And he shows it out there on the floor. But it's not just the skill. it's the fierce competitiveness, and that's what separates him from being a good player to an elite player.
And you see that show up after that 2-10 he had to serve earlier in the game.
Yes.
Great response with a goal, 3 points for Lucas Littlejohn. Let's see if he builds upon that. Power play begins for the Warriors. Halfway through the third period, two goal difference as Littlejohn gets it back. Soriketti has it, tries to take a chance through traffic, bounced off McIsaac, rolls towards Whitby bench. Speedy recovery there. Budway tried it towards the net, lost it to the Mountaineers. Good move by Langille. Played the body, collected the ball, managed a shot as the clock was running out.
That was mightily close. I thought maybe he got it off in time, but Joel Furman disagrees, says the shot's not clean enough.
Lee splitting defenders, trying to get close now, attempted an underhand pass and turned it over instead. Hustling the other way, Garlison spins away, good button hook move there, and lets Littlejohn look after it.
Yeah, smart play by Darlison. Slow it down. I know he loves to get involved in the offense. Let your power play get going. Let the offensive guys start swinging the rock.
More than halfway through their power play. No result for the Warriors yet. McCafferty goes right. Back to the left side. Good shot there by Littlejohn. And it'll be Whitby with the possession again. McCafferty to the right side, continued by Soriketti down low. Soriketti got it back. Now McCafferty again, loading up, goes for the pass instead. Back to McCafferty up top, fakes over to Soriketti for a chance, turned it over to Gurry. He's rushing out of the zone for the Mountaineers. Four out of the five Mountaineers go for a change, except to Gurry, looking for the reinforcements. Dudeman goes against the boards. He picks Moran Weeks instead. Moran Weeks for Thompson, who joins the play. For Lee. Justin Lee now for Dudeman. A little too hot for him to handle. Moran Weeks close enough. Can't tuck it in either. Warriors desperately hustling out of the zone. Good speed here from the Warriors. Oldman now steered into the boards for a moment. Cursed out of the box and getting physical right away. Littlejohn on behalf of the Warriors brings it in. Knox, he looks after it now. To the right side. Continuing down low. Warriors send it across the zone, redirected behind the net, collected by Whittem quickly. Whittem launches that in the direction of McDonnell, avoiding the other number eight on the floor, Soriketti. Soriketti versus McDonnell. McDonnell finds Dudeman for Waters. Dudeman again. Put it behind himself, not sure who it was intended for. Warriors trying to capitalize, stick a little too high on Tapper there. Nonetheless, Warriors have it. Tried to send it upwards to Weller, turned it over. Waters has it now for the Mountaineers. Asenza continues left. Thompson has it. Bouncer to Kirst. Dudeman loads up, takes a chance. Can't beat the left side of Harwood. Warriors now over to Weller. High above everyone, and Weller from the left side.
How about Ethan Harwood? He has been so steady since coming in relief for Martin. The former Green Gale just standing on his head, not really coming away with some beautiful saves, just so calm, cool, and collected.
Warriors putting the pressure on now, taking a chance. Final 5 seconds on the shot clock in their favor. As Littlejohn trying to split to Gurry, and another defender looks to be Brown and can't beat Whittem that way. Whittem now, quick pass to Taguri on the right side. Taguri moving it forward. Moran Weeks has it. Moran Weeks away from the boards. Over to Justin Lee. Lee, plenty of space, charging in now, getting creative as he slid in for a shot. Can't beat Harwood that way. Warriors now the other way quickly as Darlison loading up. Beats Brennan. Can't beat Whittem. Just wide. Mountaineers now trying to bring that down from sky high. McGee says not like that. Begley, now he's found another player to make friends with. And here we go. McGee, Begley. This is what Cole Begley must have been looking for. And he got it. Tough customer, Dylan McGee. McGee loading up. Punching Begley. They're trading back and forth. It could be anyone's fight at this point. In front of the penalty box. McGee getting it up. On Begley, Begley gets a left in, another left, now a right. tugging away at McGee. Gives him another headshot there, and they're going at it, and gets the knee involved, and that'll be it.
Yeah, Cole Bagley's going to see a lot more than just a five in a game. Throws the knee at the end. We'll see how this all starts. Darlison misses the chance here. Ball's up in the floor. Big hit. I think we'll have to wait to see if there was an initial penalty there. Might have just been the possession call, but then here goes quite the spirit. I thought the refs were going to jump in a couple of times as McGee looked like he was gassed and didn't want to go. But Begley throws a couple of heavy lefts, or sorry, heavy rights, but then McGee comes in, switches hands. I assume that's his first fight. This is an American kid coming up playing box across, holds his own. This is where I think the fight's going to end. Here comes the extra couple of shots. Ecclestone kind of says let's end it. It doesn't. And then there's the clear knee right to the gut of McGee. Not too sure why the officials did not break it up earlier, because that probably could have been avoided. Now, I'm not trying to defend the acts of Begley there with the knee, but it was very, very clear that one side was pretty much done with the fight there. Usually that's an indication where it should be broken up. Instead, it continues, and Begley loses his cool and throws that knee.
Getting a taste of Texas toughness is how I would describe that. Because you are right, quite the spirited bout from both sides. Whether it's the mighty man from Mimico, Cole Begley, or, as I mentioned, the toughness of Texas, Dylan McGee. Here's another look at how everything unfolded a moment ago.
So I think the ball was actually in the stick of Ben McIsaac. So don't know if there was an initial penalty there, but that's exactly when Cole Begley knew, yep, we're going. And that's where everything started. We see Mike White getting an explanation from both officials now.
Even from last night's game, I'd imagine that the Warriors were well aware of number 23 in double blue and what he could be capable of tonight. Definitely showed it a few moments ago as Mac Abbott now approaches the timekeeper to sort out these details. Robinson in the box for the side of the Warriors. Looks like it'll be Cam Azenza serving that penalty on behalf of Cole Begley.
So just looking at the score sheet, McGee gets five for a fight. Begley gets five for a fight. And it looks like McGee's going to get the initial two for the rough. But again, and another 5 minute for Cole Begley for kneeing. So when all is said and done, it looks like we're going to be 4-on-4 for 2 minutes, and then it will be a power play for 3 for Whitby.
A shot taken there by Little John, and credit to you, Pat, for managing to sort that out from our vantage point. Well done. As play resumes in favor of the Mountaineers the other way, Dudeman has it. Over to Kurse as he picks up speed, getting away from Oldman. Now to Dudeman, intended for Lee, just out of his reach, caught up to it anyhow. Pulling away from Oldman, turned it over instead, and it's the Warriors trying to go the other way. They turn it back over, couldn't get the transition that the Mountaineers were looking for. Oldman now keeping away from Thompson. Oldman gets a stick on Thompson, rolls over towards McDonnell. More stick work on McDonnell. Thompson hustling away. Hanser confronts him. Short pass over to Kirst as he rejoins the floor. Kirst pulling away, Doolittle keeping up with him, fell behind him, Dudeman now over to Thompson, and he can't beat Harwood that time. Harwood now trapping it, Thompson got a stick in there, Lee stepping in for the captain.
Harwood, a angles stopper, plays more like a blocker, but there goes pipe to pipe, makes a very athletic save on one of the most skilled players in the OJ, in Tanner Thompson. Or sorry, my apologies.
Finn Thompson,
Tanner Thompson, his older brother, on the bench coaching this offense.
Assistant coach of the Mimico Mountaineers, absolutely. Great lacrosse family for what it's worth.
Oh,
I had
yes.
so much fun to research and learn about them as well, heading into games one and two.
Keaton Thompson as well, a member of the Halifax Thunderbirds, playing in the National Lacrosse League as well. So a ton of talent in the Thompson family. And during his playing days with the Mountaineers, Tanner Thompson, a huge hit there. But Tanner Thompson was the mayor of Mimico. I think he might have a running mate in his younger brother, Finn, now.
Robinson rejoins the floor as Warriors have the power play for 2:37 following that 5-minute major served to Cole Begley.
Huge,
for kneeing.
Huge opportunity here for Whitby.
Little John accepts that from Knox. Keeps it going to the right side. Langille gets it back. Now to Little John. Little John moving in. Inside, close enough. In tight, unaware! And they bring it within one!
This is just such an unfortunate bounce for Mimico, and especially Whittam, who's been lights out tonight. Here comes the pass, goes off defender, and Whittam has no idea where the ball is. But Lucas Littlejohn, with the wherewithal, with the heads up to continue towards Cage, picks up the loose ball and puts it in the back of the net to get this game within one. And yes, because it is a major, the Mountaineers are still going to have to kill off this penalty, and Whitby with another man advantage.
Second goal of the contest, 4 points tonight for number 27 in red. And there he is again with the ball, calling the play. Halfway through their shot clock, everybody is set up. Soriketti got that back from Langille. Now to Little John, down low. Little John gets it back now, and there's another penalty coming up. McCafferty making life difficult for Aiden McDonnell. We'll see the replay in just a moment.
High stick, and see them right there in the middle of the floor. Great job by McCafferty. Gets a high stick right up there, and Mac Abbott, no doubt, going to call that one for high sticking. As the Mountaineers are all sorts of fired up, as now they have an opportunity. 4-on-4 here. But as we've seen this unit play 4-on-4, they are deadly.
The more and more I see 4-on-4 between these two teams, I love how much they utilize the far more open space. Long-range passes, great long-range shots that make their way towards the net as they try to beat the opposing netminder on each side. Didn't happen that time as the Mountaineers couldn't beat Harwood. Chasing the ball now, good underhand scoop of it by Tapper, pushing it forward instead. Tapper getting away from Lee, has to get creative, a swipe at it, wide of the net though. Behind the net, Lee trying to pick it up, get some help from McIsaac. Thompson takes it from McIsaac. Over to Moran Weeks, who joins the play. Moran Weeks getting away from Hanser. And just outside for Waters. Waters brings it in from the right side. Moran Weeks now. Looking for options, picks up the pace himself, takes a chance, and right at the left pad of Harwood. Doolittle to get it started.
And here comes Harwood. We're going to get an extra attacker. 5-on-4 here for the Warriors now.
One goal difference as we've entered the final 2 minutes of regulation. Knox sends it across to Soriketti. Knox got it back. Budway to Little John. Little John trying to sneak one in on that short right side of Whittam. Didn't work that time. Little John quickly on that loose ball in the corner to Budway. Knox. Little John now, final 90 seconds of regulation. Giving it back and forth with Soriketti. They get Langille involved as well. Across the zone, takes a chance, Budway, and it bounces back in the direction of Knox, stolen by the Mountaineers. Hartwood rushing back to the net. Has to get in place, he does, but he can't stop Brennan.
Huge block by Aaron Tagorian. Down goes the other way. It's Brennan, picks up the loose ball. A great hustle as Harwood gets to the cage, makes the save, but it's not enough as Brennan tickles Twine right in front of that Mimico cheering section and increases the lead to 2 with 10, a minute 10 to go in this third period.
First of the game for Caden Brennan. 9 points in the regular season for Brennan. 0 points in game one at Mimico Arena. But this first point of his 2023 Junior A Lacrosse postseason might be the biggest yet.
Absolutely tough to beat is Brennan. A beauty in transition. Like mentioned, Harwood makes the initial save, but it's not enough. So face-off ensues here, and it is huge.
Oldman with the necessary win from McIsaac. Harwood rushes to the bench again, and Knox hustles into the play. Final minute of regulation, 2-goal difference. Whitby looking to tie the series. Little John goes underhand, bounces in front of Whittam. And off of Whittam again, towards the board. McDonnell trying to catch up to it, he does. McDonnell now against the empty net, takes a chance, wide of it, behind the net now. Knox with the big scoop.
Timeout called by Whitby. Kevin Jenkins has the clipboard out, gonna try to draw something up. That, never want to see one of your defenders try to go for that yawning cage, but you can see all his teammates going over saying, don't worry, we got you. We're going to kill this off. We're not going to allow that play to come back. But as you see there, you got to assume the ball's going to start. Look at it here. Here is that potential insurance marker. And if Harwood is in cage the whole time, I think he has enough to make the save, but he loses track of where he is in the net, gets a glove on it, and Brennan scoring the biggest goal of his junior career. Certainly the biggest goal for this team so far in this postseason.
Whenever the Warriors found themselves in this situation throughout the game, whether they trail by 2 or trail by 3, they always found a way to respond quickly. Now more than ever, 2 goals in 36 seconds to prolong this game. I mean 3 goals in 36 seconds from a team like this. It's very much possible.
It certainly is.
And here they go, Riley Knox to start all the way from the empty net in Whitby zone. Connects with Little John. Little John to Soriketti, returns it to Little John, tries to sneak it through traffic, and Whittam holds tight. Whittam now launches that towards Brennan. Brennan now moving towards the empty net one more time, and there it is. His second empty net goal of the period.
Let's see, this one's a lot easier than the last one. Nonetheless, obviously has to find that ball, run it down the floor. It's a two spot for Brennan. I think the Warriors are getting a penalty here. Is delay a game, I think I heard coming from the...
As they get that sorted, I'll correct myself briefly. His second goal of the period, his first empty net of the third period, but two big goals in this third period as this game begins to wind down. Little John makes his way to the penalty box.
So 20 seconds here. Whippy's gonna have to double, try to get the ball back.
Taguri to the other side for McIsaac. Soft passing as regulation runs out. And a big game two victory for the Mimico Mountaineers.
Certainly a tighter contest nonetheless, but just a spirited bout from both sides, but Mimico showing the wherewithal to continue to battle through the pushes that Whitby had. But the play in between the pipes from Nate Whittem, the center Wellington product, just was lights out here tonight for the Mountaineers, making 40 saves en route to their second win of this series.
Plenty of supporters from the other side of the 401 this evening for the Mimico Mountaineers. And they have a 2-0 series lead heading back to Mimico Arena. A big game three awaits them back at Mimico Arena. And we'll bring you a game three as well. Join us for game three between the Oakville Buzz and the Toronto Beaches this Sunday afternoon at 2 p.m. right here on the OJLL channel on YouTube. But for now, we get ready to say goodbye from Iroquois Park. For all of us here, I say good night on behalf of Pat Gregoire, Chris and Gary behind the scenes. I'm Angst Kumar, and there's one more look at the victors of game two. Mountaineers 14, Warriors 11. Good night from Iroquois Park.